Newton tells us particles travel in straight lines. If there's no force acting on them, for them to make a change in direction, a change in momentum, takes force. Okay, but there is no force on these particles. Yet these particles that are basically flying free, if you will, and pass through a slit, rearrange themselves in a diffraction pattern, which means there's some parts of the screen where they bunch up and other parts of the screen where they won't go, that they avoid. And they do this in a very specific pattern, in a very specific numbers, you know, bunch up, and then there'll be a space where they're not, and then they'll bunch up to a lesser extent in a space where they're not, and so on. It's a very precise way that they distribute themselves. Not a haphazard way, not a random way, but a very precise way, with no forces to have them do that. Well, in the material world, in the clockwork universe, this can't happen. Particles don't just distribute themselves in distributions without any force being on them. So it is a, you know, it's a wrench in the monkey works of materialism. It doesn't, you know, the material world doesn't function that way. So that says that the material world is not the fundamental world. That the material world seems to be material, but at its root, it is not. Because these are the particles. The particles make up the atoms, make up the molecules. The molecules make up the physical world. So at the basis of this physical world, you have particles that don't behave as material particles. Then you have to question the whole physical system. It's really not based in a deterministic materialism. So that's what the double slit experiment did. And that's what made it so famous. That's why it is the big thing that started quantum mechanics in the first place. If that experiment wasn't so outrageously difficult to understand by the people of that time, then nobody would have ever heard of it. I mean, this was an experiment that was done in the early 1920, 1925, up through that time is when these experiments were being done. And they're done in such a way, because they're delayed erasure experiments, they're done in such a way that the only explanation can be that it's a probabilistic reality. Probabilistic reality cannot be deterministic. Determinism and probability are, you know, don't work together. Determinism says it is going to be this way. Probability says, it might be that way, it might not. Here's the probabilities. You see, so probability is antithetical to determinism. So, and some people may argue with that if they do ensembles and clusters, but at the particle level that we're talking about, you know, it's different. So anyway, so the only way these can be explained is that there are no particles. The particles don't really exist. There's only potential particles, possible particles, probable particles. And depending on how we measure and what we measure, those probable particles will end up in diffraction patterns or in clump patterns or someplace else. And the reason that they, and another criteria is that, and it's actually part of this last criteria I just mentioned, is that time is always going to move forward linearly. You're never going to have things going backward in time. A lot of people interpret the delayed erasure experiments as something going backward in time. Oh, you made a change after the fact of collecting the data, and now the data changes. So the data must have changed in arrears. The data changed after you made, you know, that change.
Retrocausality.
Yeah, it's retrocausality. You see, and the reason they say that is you collect data on a screen, then you change whether or not you have which-way data after you've already collected the data. But the data on the screen turns out to be consistent with the which-way data that you've got, which you changed after you collected the data on the screen. So it looks like that screen had to change after the change in the which-way data occurred. You see? Well, it doesn't work like that. It's very difficult in a simulation to go backwards in time. It creates all kinds of logical inconsistencies to run backwards in time. So what is put on that screen has to be aware of the fact that the which-way data might change. And it isn't put on that screen, even the particles get there, okay, it either isn't put on that screen until after the which-way data can no longer be changed, or the which-way data gets changed in order to fit what's put on the screen. You see, those are two ways to accomplish that. You can say, okay, here's what went on the screen, now the which-way data is going to have to be manipulated to suit that. Or what's on the screen has to be unlooked at, unverified, unmeasured. And if it's unmeasured, you could say, well, it just is still in potential. It's not really anything on that screen yet until somebody makes a measurement of what's on that screen. There's nothing on that screen. And now after the which-way data is done, now you can put something on that screen. You see, so that's one way to look at it and say that the screen, even though the particles have hit there, until somebody makes the measurement, they're not really particles. They're just potential particles. And it's only until somebody actually looks at that screen that the actual particles have to have a position. But my prediction is that they will manipulate the selection of the which-way data, whether it gets erased or not erased. They will manipulate that. And they'll do that by manipulating whether things reflect or transmit at a beam splitter, or whether or not a random atomic decay erases or doesn't erase the data. You see, so that's how I'm going to be able to predict about the transmission or reflection, or about the random direction of a particle comes out of, an element, because I think the system put in that situation where it can't finesse the problem is stuck, and it's going to have to do something dramatic. And changing a function that by materialism must be 50-50, you know, whether it reflects or doesn't at a beam splitter, to something that is predictable, well, that's going to be something unexpected. It's going to be completely unexpected. So that's kind of what the experiments are doing. They're taking the original double slit a step further and forcing the system to show us how it's going to solve the problem. Is that given that this reality is consciousness-based, is a virtual reality, then virtual realities are extant, that they exist only in the minds of the players. There really is no virtual reality. You know, in World of Warcraft, there really is no place where a bunch of little elves and barbarians and monsters run around, you know, hiding in caves and fighting with each other. It doesn't really exist. It only exists in the minds of the players. The players get data streams. They interpret the data streams as this reality, and it's a multiplayer game. So they have to see the same things, more or less. Their interpretations have to be similar, because it's a multiplayer game. So, if that's the case, and this is a virtual reality with people getting data streams and then interpreting them as this physical universe that we get, then nothing really comes into this virtual physical universe until data gets into the mind of a player. When a player gets the data that says there's a rock sitting here, well, now that's a rock, that's a measurement, and that rock now is in the virtual reality. because a player has measured it, has gotten it, and interpreted it, you see. Until that happens, there is no rock. Because the only thing that creates a rock is a data stream. Oh, I see a printout here that says a particle, that last particle went through slit A instead of slit B. Well, now that's information here, and that becomes part of this reality. But without that information being here, whether it was detected or not, shouldn't make any difference. So that's why I thought that just turning off the recorders should be sufficient to create a diffraction pattern. You see? And that makes me a lonely person of one versus, you know, all the quantum mechanics, you know, experts. And I am not a quantum mechanics expert. But it's my theory that this is a virtual reality, that and that time has to move forward, and that the most efficient way it'll compute is the way chosen, and so on. It comes out with that. So you take quantum theorists who say they have no idea why it works that way. You take Richard Feynman, who is one of the better quantum theorists, and he said, we'll never know why it works that way. And the mysteries of the double slit experiment hold the key to understanding this thing, and we have no idea what those mysteries are. Well, if there's that much ignorance of the fundamentals that are in the foundation of quantum mechanics, then I'm not so quick to say, well, if that's what the quantum theorists think, then obviously that must be true. See? Little Tom Campbell, who's not a quantum theorist. I mean, when I got out of graduate school, I worked in the real world. The real world doesn't do a lot of quantum theory. Some places do, but mostly in the real world I worked in, it was all Newtonian theory. Things didn't go so fast they needed relativity, nor were they so small that they needed quantum mechanics. You know? Very seldom do scientists get a totally new out-of-the-box idea, and then from there on, everything they do turns out, you know, just the way they expect. It hardly ever works that way. The way science has always worked in the past is somebody has a bright idea, and they test it, and some of it works, and some of it doesn't, so they learn.